Hello. Okay, so we are starting a new reading vlog today, and we will be choosing my reads from a random number generator. So let's choose English first. So let me write this down. And Spanish is book number 9. Okay, so let's go to my shelf. Sorry for the garbage lighting over here. So we're not picking the weird because this is like a 1,000-page short story collection. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Song of Solomon. Ooh, okay. Spanish. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay. El mapa de los anhelos. I kind of don't think I'm gonna like this. I ordered it sort of on a whim. Since then, I've heard more things about it that have made me think I'm not going to like it, but we shall see. So let me unwrap this. Okay, so here are my reads. These were, I don't know why I had expected books. I don't know. But they aren't what I expected. We're gonna get into it. It is only 8:30, so I should have time to read a little bit of both of these. So, yeah. Lengths to which I will go to avoid setting up a proper tripod and such are truly incredible. We are in day 2 and things are going well. I was concerned about these books because both of these are quite heavy topical books. So Song of Solomon is one of, I believe, Toni Morrison's less well-known, you know, obviously, like, she didn't write that many books, so, like, it's not like any of them are, like, unsung, but I know that this one has a reputation for being quite different than her other books because I think in the foreword even it talked about being, like, male-focused versus most of her books being incredibly, you know, centered around women. And so this is the story of a man, right now he's a boy or a teenager, but named Milkman Dead. Yeah, so I've only read 2 chapters, but they are fairly long, so I think I'm at like 15-18%, something like that, and I am loving it so far. Her writing is just, oh my god, like, I marked this line that just, it's not even an important line, like, it's not even saying anything profound, but it's talking about the mother being obsessed with this water stain on her table, and it said, like, oh, she talked endlessly to her daughters and her guests about how to get rid of it, what might hide the single flaw on the splendid wood. Vaseline, tobacco, juice, iodine, a sanding followed by linseed oil. She had tried them all, but her glance was nutritious. The spot became, if anything, more pronounced as the years passed. Her glance was nutritious. How do you come up with that? How do you think of those words? Like, maybe this is like a phrase that people say and I'm just like totally missing it, but like, her glance was nutritious. Like, that just, I like stopped reading and was like, what? So anyway, obviously there's more important things in here than that, but yeah. So going well, definitely need to read obviously a lot more. And this one, the reason why I thought that I might not like this is because this does center around a girl whose sister dies. And I have sisters that I am very close to, and I do not like media that talks about sisters dying. That is why I stopped watching Midsommar. I have still not watched the movie Midsommar, not because of the horror, but because I started watching it and her sister dies and she falls into a deep depression, and I literally couldn't make it through the first 5 minutes of the movie. I was like, absolutely not. No. I was very concerned about reading this because of that reason, but I kind of just like blocked it out, and I was like, we'll just see how much it centers on that. And it is like fully about that. And I mean, I'm only like 4 chapters. I've read like 3 chapters, but her sister has died, and I don't know, it is sad, obviously. Anyway, I'm rambling way too much about this, but so far it's fine. There was one section that I laughed about a lot. I'm gonna see if I can rapid translate this. So if you were gonna describe him like any normal person would, dark hair, hard feature, sharp features, too tall for my liking, shoulders in tension, blah, 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 blah. But then it says, but if you were going to describe how his, what his presence evoked, grains of popcorn over a something converting into popcorn, turning into popcorn, a butterfly, a blue butterfly on the point of death, fresh water falling over a mountain waterfall. I have never looked at a person before and thought, you know what this person reminds me of? Pieces of corn popping. So like that was like very YA right there, like very YA, but otherwise things are going well. So hello. So just an update. I am halfway through Song of Solomon and I am really, really liking this. Obviously the writing is absolutely incredible. I don't love most of the characters, but I don't think that you're like supposed to. There's not really a plot. You're just kind of following this character. I am not particular. You know, I am fine with character-driven books. I'm fine with plot-driven books. I'm fine with vibe-driven books. Like, I really am not particular, and so I am really, really enjoying this. So yeah, not a whole lot to say here. It has made me laugh out loud multiple times, but also, you know, definitely has heavy themes, but handled in such a creative way. Just, I am always absolutely in awe of Toni Morrison's writing. So I don't know if I ever like said what this title is in English, but it's The Map of Dreams, Desires, something like that. And so yeah, I'm about 30% in to this one, so I need to dedicate some serious time to this week. I think I really want to finish it this week, but it's already Wednesday. I want to finish both of these this week, so I need to buckle down. But I am liking this one. I think that for me, it is too long for what it is. We're following the main character who is 22 and her sister has died. And she is given the map of longings, maybe, as a gift after her sister dies from her sister. And so it is kind of trying to help her heal from this, seemingly gonna be also like a slow burn romance, and so that is kind of developing, and I think that that is primarily what's supposed to be keeping you know, riveted to this story. And I did enjoy romance a lot more when I was a teenager, and so I think if I had read this as a teenager, which I think is definitely the target audience, I'm sure I would have been more invested, but I'm not invested, you know, like I do like it, but I just think for my personal taste, I would prefer a little bit more plot, but, you know, there have been sweet sections and stuff. I do think that this would be an incredibly cringy book to read as a native Spanish speaker, or if it was written in English. There have been sections that even as, like, a non-fluent, like, Spanish speaker, I'm kind of like, ugh. I think, you know, I read one of them when I first started, but yeah, there have just been some, like, trying to be really picturesque, trying to be really profound things that I can tell just don't quite come off. But again, I am liking it. It is funny, again, this has come up twice now, reading books that are set in the US by authors from Spain, where they have just been really confused about the US in very funny, oddly specific ways, because I feel like normally you'd read something and think like, oh, culturally this doesn't quite fit or something, but they've been like very specific things, like the book Rojo was like a vampire story, and it was completely confused about the climate and what the landscape is like of New Jersey, which is where it was set. This one is set in Nebraska. And she keeps saying hurricanes. She keeps saying that they get hurricanes. She means tornadoes, but she definitely keeps saying hurricanes. And also, this had to have come like straight off of the Wikipedia page for Nebraska. At one point she was talking about, I posted the quote on my Instagram, so I should be able to put it on the screen. But she said, like, in Nebraska, they only talk about three things: harvest, livestock, and Kool-Aid, which was invented in Nebraska. Which, I really doubt that that is a major conversation topic in Nebraska. I've never been to Nebraska, but I really doubt that. So that was truly a moment of hilarity in reading this. But anyway, yeah, both of these books are going really well. I have no complaints. So, oh, I forgot. We are having the smoke from the forest fires in Canada. So that has been a very odd, you know, thing. Today was the worst day so far. It's not quite as dramatic here as in New York City because, you know, visually dramatic. We have the same air quality levels, but it's not like the red, but it is wild. Like, today was sunny. Like, if you looked at the weather app, there were no clouds, but you would have thought that it was a completely overcast day. Like, you couldn't see anything. And like, your eyes would get itchy if you were outside for very long. The whole drive home from work, my eyes were so itchy, and I have had headaches for days. So obviously very, very minor concerns here for us, compared to the people in Canada that are having to, you know, evacuate and everything. So yeah, very concerning. Anyway. Hello. It is Friday. I'm sorry that my fan is on, but I just wanted to record this quick clip as accountability that I am going to try to finish this book. And yeah, I am armed with a smoothie and I'm just going to get reading. Holy wow. So this had just started to really go off the rails before I started filming that last clip. It's done. I am reeling. Hello. So, it is Sunday, and so I am going to try to finish this book today. I do have like 5 hours left of it, so I'm not sure how well that's gonna go for me, But the air quality is a little bit better today, so I am taking advantage of some time at the park before it's supposed to absolutely pour all day. So I will have to relocate hopefully before that happens. So I am halfway through this, and we just switched perspectives to the male character, which I did not know was going to happen. So I am very interested to finally find out his story and see how he knew the main character's sister, and yeah, so I need to get reading. I'm not really sure how it's happening, but I'm fairly sure that time is slowing down every single time I open this book. Some kind of witchcraft is going on. I don't dislike it, but oh my god, every time I think I've read for at least an hour, it's been like 20 minutes. I'm all the way up to 1.75 speed on the audiobook, which is definitely the fastest that I've ever been on for a Spanish book. Okay, we have succeeded in our goals. So, finished the map of longings. This was really sweet and thoughtful in the end. I do think that it was pretty well done. Like, there is no way that this needed to be almost 500 pages. Not even a little bit, but I do really like the way that it handled the topics that it talked about. I mean, I don't know what it is like to lose an immediate family member, and so I can't vouch for how, you know, that specifically was handled. But I liked that it didn't really overly simplify things, I don't think. Even the romance, like, both of them had a lot of things to work through. Obviously, the girl who lost her sister, but also the guy had, you know, a complicated history and was kind of at risk of being one of those things where they, like, heal each other, you know, and she made sure for that not to be the case, that they both had to fix their shit. And so I liked that. I think that's, you know, a rare amount of thought put into kind of a YA romance. I don't know that this is YA, probably new adult. It does have some spice, and I don't know really if YA books can have that. I don't know. That one has not been translated into English, so I won't really talk about it more. But, then we have Song of Solomon by Toni Morrison. Obviously, this was amazing, obviously. I was a little bit nervous about this because this is actually the first full-length novel that I have read of Toni Morrison's. I know, but I've read her essays, I read Recitative, but I had not read a full-length novel yet, and like, I knew that I was going to be obsessed, but again, this is not one that people recommend reading first usually, and so I was nervous about it, but wow, incredible. I can't wait to read more of her, like, women-focused novels. I feel like I need to take, like, a university course on this book in order to actually be able to, like, fully appreciate it, fully understand what it is doing. But yeah, this is great. Definitely should get more appreciation in the unhinged novel sector that is currently popular. But yeah, it was funny because I had literally just been saying in one of the clips that, like, it was not really very full of plot. You know, it was kind of just slowly developing these characters. And like, almost immediately after I filmed that, like, hit the fan for real. And so yeah, very, very interesting book. I do think, I mean, it's hard to review books like this, but I think this is one that is best to go in not really knowing very much, just because it will be such an immersive, bizarre experience if you don't know very much. So yeah, I'm sure most people don't need my recommendation to read Toni Morrison, but if you have been, you know, kind of stuck not reading any of her works like I have been, where I just know that I'm going to read all of them and be obsessed with all of them, but I just hadn't, you know, had that kick in the pants to get started on them yet, definitely do it. So this was a really, really good little activity to get started on reading some more of my unread shelf. I think I am going to continue doing this every month, where either I do the random number generator, or I have Instagram pick two books, or I just pick two books that I want to read. Something where at least once a month I just pick two books so that I'm at least getting through that many, hopefully more than that. But, you know, if you have read either of these books, presumably probably Song of Solomon or the other one, I would love to hear your thoughts. Or if you have reviews, you could tell me below. Links are blocked in my comments. But yeah, thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next video.